Okay, everyone. I'm so happy to be back. I haven't been, the last time I did this was 2017. I did it for about 10 years, and I'm glad to be back. And I brought Ricky here in 2008, and I think he should, he wore this shirt. Yes. Well, I can finish the story about the shirt. He wore the shirt, and he'd wear it every year. I think they should frame the shirt and put it in the Jazz Museum because it was a turning point in the history of the Satchmo Summerfest, the arrival of Ricky Riccardi on the scene. As you can see, the sanitizing is happening. Behind-the-scenes action. Remember to wear your mask indoors at the museum, as you all are, and to sanitize regularly. There's a little hand sanitizer pump machines about. Also, I would go see Wendell Brunius after Ricky is done. Are you going to do that, Ricky?
I am.
So am I. And here they come. Stephen's not coming, so you could. Is he here? Oh, he's no, he's coming. Yeah, that looks good to me.
Yeah. Hey.
Hey, Randy, how's it going?
Good to see you.
You know, he just let people know that he has two autographed books. I saw that on the Facebook.
Yes. Let me take it. We got it. Yeah, we can do that.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. If John McCusker was the penultimate presentation, we have arrived at the ultimate presentation, meaning the last. That's right. My name is John Pult. I'm here to welcome you to the Satchmo Legacy Stage at this, the 21st annual Satchmo Summerfest presented by Chevron. Let's give a hand to, you know, the French Quarter Festivals who produce the festival. They do such a great job with a very small staff, and they just do a wonderful thing. And isn't it great to be back out with people, like-minded people who like Louis Armstrong, right? It's a good idea to like Louis Armstrong. That's right. This guy, like, he saw a movie of Louis Armstrong, and now, like, he works at his house.
In charge of his trumpets.
That's right. He's in charge of his trumpets. That's a good arc. You know, it's a good story, Ricky. Anyway, the this is the only festival in Louisiana dedicated to Louis Armstrong, and it's produced by French Quarter Festivals, as I said, which is a nonprofit, and they have been showcasing New Orleans culture and heritage since 1984, the year I graduated from high school. Although it was just a little, this past year is a little 1984-y. If you've enjoyed anything you've seen here today, or you really want to tease out that joke I made where I said I met John McCusker 30 years ago, I was 9. See, why isn't that going anywhere? My God, that was my best one. You could watch them again on the French Quarter Festival Facebook page. But don't get your vaccine information there, or the French Quarter Festival YouTube page, and they'll all be able to they'll be archived there. So we're going to thank our sponsors, including Chevron. As you can see, that logo is a chevron, and the New Orleans Jazz Museum at the Mint. Let's give them a big hand for hosting us. Aiden and Travis, take a bow. Very good. Also, this year the stage is dedicated to the memory of Joni Barry, a great friend of this festival. Stephen might come, so that's his chair. Stephen wanted to pay tribute to his wife who passed away last year by dedicating the stage to her. She was a great friend of the festival. Please take a minute to read the little story about her that's posted in various places around the Mint. Also, the Ella Fitzgerald Charitable Foundation, Janice Folks, give Janice a hand, she's back there. And Richie and Vicky Nurigan, who can't be with us this year. They're New Jersey?
Mahwah, New Jersey.
Mahwah, New Jersey. So there's that. Also from Tom's River, home of the famous clown parade. That's true.
No, it is.
It's true. Hey, everything I say up here is true. See, because you know what? That's a chevron. Here we have Ricky Riccardi. Give him a big hand, just the preliminary big hand. As I said, he's the archivist for the Louis Armstrong House Museum, and I'm sure at some point over this the next day, maybe you could give us an update on the house, the new museum space, and what the pandemic effect has on that. Always go visit and call first, and maybe he'll come over and he'll show you around the house. So he, as I said, he's been here every year since 2008 with us, and in that time, I heard him get offered the job in the back of my car from the late, great Michael Cogswell, and you know, it was so funny. He was got here as like this wide-eyed. He'd be going, "Oh my God, George Avakian is sitting at the next table," and it was just crazy for him. And then, you know, he just became so quickly the center of so much that we've done here, and his work is just exemplary. His two books. How many have his books? I know Randy does. Who else has his books? Okay. We need some converts here, yeah. Ricky. But his latest won the Jazz Times. The first one is called "The Magic." What a Wonderful World: The Magic of Louis Armstrong's Later Years, where he kind of reassessed what people thought. He was just kind of coasting and doing, you know, songs like "What a Wonderful World," which the jazz cognoscenti said, "Well, you know, he's old," and he reassessed all that. And then most recently, which, as I said, won the Jazz Times Best Jazz Book of 2020. And you know, people read more in 2020 because they had more time on their hands. And that one's called "Heart Full of Rhythm." And this presentation now is based on around that book. And he bookended today, and will bookend tomorrow as well. Give him the big warm Satchmo welcome. Ricky Riccardi.
Thank you. All right. Thank you, John. Do we have juice?
We got juice.
We got juice. All right. We're good. All right. So, yes, 1 year ago, almost to the day, my second book, Heart Full of Rhythm, came out. I had a whole thing planned. This was going to be the launch, and then the book tour and all that stuff. Became the Zoom tour very quickly. So less than a year later, we're here. It's better late than never. But I've spent the last year talking about the book. Last year for the virtual Satchmo Summerfest, Maxine Gordon and I, Maxine will be here tomorrow with me, we did a whole talk about the book and what were the themes of the book, what was the process of the book. So I don't want to go down that road again today. My bag since 2008 has always been closing each day with videos because we talk about him all day, and then every musician out there is paying tribute to him. But this is the space for him to just do his thing, and it makes my job much easier as well. So I figured to tie it into the book, I wanted to pick footage that ties into the years I cover, which is 1929 to 1947. Normally I show later footage because I still think TV was the best visual showcase for Louis Armstrong. There's no corny scripts. There's no bad acting. There's no overdubbed trumpet playing. It's live. It's him. You can't miss it. So some stuff I'm going to show today will address some issues. It's definitely some of it's more problematic than others. But what he does with it, I think, is always, you know, with incredible dignity and incredible musicianship. And it's a deep story, you know, African-Americans in Hollywood. And you don't think of that really as a part of the Louis Armstrong life. But in 1941, Leonard Feather asked him to name the highlights of his career. They put a phony kind of publicity thing, you know, 25 years in show business. And they said, what are your biggest accomplishments? And the first thing he listed was when he hosted a radio show. He was the first African-American to host a nationally sponsored syndicated radio show, the Fleischman's East Show in 1937, which we'll talk about later. And then the second thing, he named all these movies he had made, Pennies from Heaven, Going Places. And like I said, they're movies that by 2021 standards, especially the parts Lewis played, it's like, I wish he'd gotten something better. But he knew that these were huge steps forward for his race in that time period. So, you know, we'll watch him and we'll analyze him and, you know, we'll see what happens. And we're going to jump right in the deep end, right? But the first surviving footage of Louis Armstrong, he made a film in California called X Flame, and it is lost. It's something about that early talkie era where they just weren't saving the films. X Flame was a major film. It was all publicity, all reviews. Lewis was mentioned. He had a featured part. He played music in a band with Lionel Hampton and Lawrence Brown. Not a trace of it has survived, not even the soundtrack. So maybe one year we'll unearth X Flame. That's kind of the holy grail. But in 1932, Armstrong was really hitting new highs in popularity. Where my book begins in 29, he had just come to New York. Musicians knew the Hot Fives and Hot Sevens, but he is as far from a household name as humanly possible. But his producer at OK Records, Tommy Rockwell, takes Armstrong from the what they call the Race Records, puts him on the pop series of OK Records, and Lewis begins recording I Can't Give You Anything But Love, and Ain't Misbehaving, Body and Soul, When You're Smiling, All of Me, Stardust. Yeah, I'm confessing that I love you. If I could be with you 1 hour. Love songs, pop songs, but he puts his own stamp on it. And what I argue is that those recordings between 29 and 32 might be the most influential recordings he made, because more people heard them and musicians memorized those solos, singers, all of a sudden they realized this is how you approach this music, and nothing was ever the same. So in early 32, right before the footage I'm about to show you, it was announced that Louis Armstrong sold more records in 1931 than any other artist, more than Bing Crosby, Guy Lombardo, Paul Whiteman, Rudy Valli, black, white, jazz, pop. Louis Armstrong is the number one seller. So, of course, Hollywood comes calling. And, of course, Hollywood in 1932, with an African-American genius, instead of saying, all right, just do your thing, they basically corner him. I'm going to show you a clip from a film called The Rhapsody in Black and Blue. It's very famous. Lewis does an old minstrel song called That's Why They Call Me Shine, which has an incredible history, written by African-Americans. And there is this kind of, there's a verse to the song that's very, you know, self-empowering. But Lewis doesn't do the verse. They have him wearing leopard skin. He's knee-deep in soap bubbles. And it's like the entire deck is stacked against him. But watch him transcend it. It's a beautiful thing. I mean, he sings. My good friend, the actor Reno Wilson, he always points out, just watch the body language. This is an actor analyzing him. It's like this beautiful example of self-love. You know, just the way he touches himself and everything, it's incredible. He winks at his black audience at one point because there's a line in there about always wearing the latest style, and he holds up the leopard skin and rolls his eyes like, do you believe this? But the thing to really watch out for is when he first starts the vocal, watch him point to himself. Now, everybody here, point to yourselves real quick. All right? Which finger did you use? Did anybody here use a middle finger? Watch Lewis's hand and watch the middle finger with a big smile on his face right in front of the camera pointing to himself. You know, he's getting the message across. And then he picks up the trumpet and just blows everything away. And this is his 1931 band. Many New Orleans musicians in the band, Preston Jackson, Tubby Hall, Zilner Randolph was the music director. And at this point, Lewis used to end his shows with 100, sometimes 200 high Cs. And we get a taste of that at the very end, just as it fades. You hear the band counting and Lewis just blasting. And why am I talking about it when I can show you? So here is Shine from A Rhapsody in Black and Blue.
You, why, I'm your royal student.
hold, please. We're listening to it right now. But I think
well,
we need to.
If you want to do something to please the king, have Louis Armstrong to play shy.
Yep. Wasn't that something? These guys are working so hard today. There it is. Yep. Okay. So this is Sid Easton. He was an African-American comedian. He was a good friend of Lewis. He had just got conked on the head by his wife, and he has this dream sequence where he is the king of Jazzmania. And this is his request to hear Louis Armstrong play Shine.
My hit will be brought to you by this magic wand.
Well, go on and brought it. What you waiting on, then?
For the finger.
Oh, chocolate drop, that's me, girl. My hair is curly, just because my teeth are burning. Oh, just because I always wear a smile. I like the dress up in the latest style, ladies' style. Just because I'm glad I'm living. Oh, I takes all my troubles, all with a smile. Just because my color shade makes different me. That's why they call me Shine.
High F at the end. So it's an incredible snapshot of what he is doing in this period. But like I said, you could write a dissertation about, you know, the film and what's going on and what they made him do. But an incredible glimpse. But the showmanship there, that's what, you know, that was his bread and butter. And soon after, he went to England. And some of the most racist reviews of his career came in England. You know, all these comparisons to an untrained gorilla and his sweating and this and that. I mean, horrible, horrible stuff. Comes back to America, goes back to Europe in July of 33, and he stays in New York until January of 35. And it's at this point that the dance band critics, it wasn't really jazz critics, but the dance band critics in England, this is where it all begins. That Lewis has gone commercial and all this stuff. They are just giving him hell no matter what he does on stage. And it's in this period that Armstrong goes to Scandinavia for the first time, and he arrives in Denmark, and there are thousands of people waiting for him when the train pulls in. And Lewis was sure the people were waiting for somebody else. But no, they were waiting for him. And God bless the Danes. They knew this was important. They were making a film, kind of a review type film. It would be a musical number and a comedian and all this kind of stuff. They said, can we film you? Sure. And so Lewis and his band, Hot Harlem Band, they were called. It was all mostly American musicians that were living overseas. They did three songs in full, in their tuxedos, no plot, no soap bubbles, no anything like that. Oh, did we lose it? There, oh, it was a good run. We're good, we're good. if anybody's been here all day, it's been suspenseful, but we're almost there. And so this has become probably the most iconic footage, and again, one of the points I'm making in the book is we now hold this up. Ken Burns shows it, and people show it on Facebook and YouTube as this is the glory of young Louis Armstrong. And the critics at the time hated this Louis Armstrong. They thought the showmanship and the singing and the mugging and all was too much. But what do they know? We don't know their names, but we're at the Louis Armstrong Festival, so we got the last laugh. Everybody shows Dinah. Everybody shows Tiger Rag. I'm going to go with I Cover the Waterfront. I Cover the Waterfront. And if you've never seen this, incredible vocal, incredible everything. You can't take your eyes off him. 1933.
Now, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Mr. Armstrong, and we're going to sing one of the good old good ones for you. Beautiful number. I Cover the Waterfront. I Cover the Waterfront. I like it. Look out there, sir. Look out there. One, two. I cover the waterfront. I'm watching the sea. Cause the one I love soon come back to me. Send it up, daddy. I cover the waterfront in search of my love. And I'm covered by the solid skies above. Oh, baby, every mind is surely waiting. Open it on your way. Are you forgetting? Will you remember? Will you return? I cover the waterfront. I'm watching the sea. Girl, the one I love will soon come back to me. I cover the waterfront. Watching the sea, baby. The one I love will soon come back to me.
So Armstrong spends, like I said, about 18 months in Europe, and then he hits rock bottom. By the start of 1935, this is what's going on. His manager, Johnny Collins, had gotten him into all sorts of trouble with the mob. That's why Lewis went to Europe in the first place. Collins calls him the N-word on the ship over to England and leaves and takes Armstrong's passport with him. So Lewis is stuck over there. He's doing that 100 high C thing every night. And one night in England, he busts his top lip and he said a chunk of meat came out and blood ran down his tuxedo shirt. And now he can't play the trumpet. His second wife, Lil, was suing him because he had been paying her weekly and those payments stopped. And all of a sudden she comes out. He had a new manager in France, and that guy double-booked Armstrong. His lips blow out again. Lewis had to cancel the gig. This guy's threatening all sorts of action. Lewis comes back. He leaves his sheet music. He leaves the band. He leaves everybody overseas. Comes back to New York in January of 35. No chops, no band, no record contract, no music, no nothing. It's the lowest point of his career. And what happens while he's gone? The swing era, you know, comes into play, and Lewis's music, his influence, finally becomes popular.
I think it's, I'm doing it too with grabbing the microphone.
Okay. There we go, showbiz. So Lewis's music, you know, his influence has now become popular music, but it's through Benny Goodman and Tommy Dorsey and Duke Ellington and all that stuff, and Lewis has nothing. And so this is when he goes to Joe Glazer, and I won't get into that now, but it's all in the book. Joe Glazer becomes Lewis's manager. He had mob ties, and he makes all of Lewis's troubles disappear. And by the end of the year, by the end of 1935, Lewis is leading Louis Russell's orchestra. He's being featured in beautiful spreads in Vanity Fair and Esquire magazine. He is touring. He's performing on Broadway. He has a recording contract with Decca, and he's back. And so in early 1936, he's playing the Metropolitan Theater in Boston. In walks probably the biggest star in the world, Bing Crosby. Bing knows that without Lewis, there's no Bing. And, you know, the two of them have a mutual appreciation society. And Bing said, listen, I'm making a picture for Columbia, Pennies from Heaven. Do you want to be in it? Sure. You know, Lewis was excited by that. Harry Cohen, the famous angry head of Columbia Pictures, didn't know why Bing Crosby wanted Louis Armstrong, but he knew it must have been important to him. So they give Louis a role in Pennies from Heaven. And not only do they give him a song, they give him a comedic sequence. And so Louis gets to show some comedy chops. And at the time, Louis said this was the biggest laugh in the picture. And in the book, I went through all the black press because they said this was finally a part we can be proud of. And Lewis steals the show from Bing Crosby, and 30 years later, Lewis talked about the scene, and he said, you know, it was the biggest laugh in the picture, because, but you can't do scenes like that anymore, because the NAACP wouldn't allow it, and so times had changed, but in 1936, it was revolutionary, and the big thing that Lewis always remembered, he was the first African-American to get featured billing in a Hollywood film, so when you see Pennies from Heaven, the four main leads all had equal billing, equal credits before the title, and there was Louis Armstrong, an African-American. So he was proud of this movie until the day he died, and I'm going to show you his comedic sequence, and then we'll go into his big showpiece, The Skeleton in the Closet, which he really gets to ham it up. I mean, his acting in the beginning, the storytelling, the hand-wringing and all that stuff jumps off the screen, and so here it is, which he called one of the highlights of his career.
Mr. Poole.
Well, hello, Henry. Did you make up your mind?
Yes, Mr. Poole, but there's a little trouble.
A little trouble? Well, speak freely.
You see, I got the boys together, and I told them you wanted us to play the music for you at the restaurant.
That's right.
And for that, we'd get 10% of the business.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the trouble started.
Oh, well, Henry, don't you think 10%'s enough?
Well, yes and no. Maybe it's enough, and maybe it's too much. But you see, Mr. Poole, there's seven men in the band.
That's counting you.
That's right, counting me. And none of us knows how to divide up 10% by seven. So if you could just only make it 7%.
Oh, 7%? Henry, it's a deal.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Poole. I told him, Cat, you'd do the right thing.
Why, sure. Well, of course. I'll see you later. Yes, sir.
It's natural. So here's the skeleton in the closet sequence.
There's an old deserted mansion on an old forgotten road where the better ghosts and goblins always hang out. One night they threw a party in a manner a la mode, and they cordially invited all the gang out. At a dark, bewitching hour, when the fun was loud and hearty, a notorious wallflower became the life of the party. The spooks were having their midnight fling. Mary Megan was in full swing. They shrieked themselves.
Uh-oh. Everybody sing along.
Now a goblin, he giggled with fiendish glee. A shout rang out from a big banshee. Amazement was in every ghostly glance when Skeleton in the Closet started to dance.
Lionel Hampton is the drummer.
Now all the witches were in stitches while his steps made rhythmic thumps. And they nearly dropped their broomsticks when he tried to do the bumps. You never heard such an earthly laughter or such hilarious groan when Skeleton in the Closet rattled his bones.
So like I said, that he named that as one of the highlights of his career. And the other thing he mentioned was this Fleischman Z show. So I'm going to cheat a little bit because the Fleischman Z show was hosted by Rudy Valli, you know, the great crooner, actor. And Rudy Valli was taking a sabbatical in 1937. And he said that I want Louis Armstrong to replace me. And this was big news because most representations of African Americans on the radio were either musicians, you know, Cab Calloway, Duke Ellington doing broadcasts, or there were white people like, you know, Amos and Andy doing black dialect. And so here was Louis Armstrong was going to host a syndicated sponsored radio show, NBC, 13 weeks. And for many years, this was kind of a footnote in the Armstrong story. People said, oh, he hosted this radio show for 13 weeks and let's move on. But Louis knew it was important. And in researching my book, the black press, they treated this like Joe Louis, like this was such a big moment. And to illustrate that, I made a video so that we're not going to see anything, but we have the audio of four complete broadcasts of the Fleischman Z show. And so I chose, of course, I've Got a Heart Full of Rhythm, the title of the book. And you'll see some of these headlines and you'll see some photos of Louis Armstrong in this period of his career, you know, breaking down another barrier.
The makers of Fleischman's Yeast bring you another fast and furious program featuring music by Louis Armstrong, the trumpet king of swing, and now the head gate himself, Louis Armstrong and his orchestra.
Now look here, got no shoes on my feet. I ain't got nothing to eat, but I've got a heart full of rhythm. Not a dime to my name, but I'm rich just the same. I've got a heart full of rhythm. When the skies are gray and everything's wrong, I find my way by singing a song. Let the great think I'm small. Boy, I can laugh at them all. I've got a heart full of rhythm. Look at you.
Albert,
now, folks, this is old Satchamouth swinging at you. Playing one of them old good ones he wrote himself. A heart full of rhythm, yes.
Paul Barber in and an incredible band. Yeah, it's Luis Russell's orchestra. Russell born in Panama, but you know, spent most of his time in New Orleans. And other New Orleans musicians, Albert Nicholas and Paul Barber and Pops Foster, Red Allen, all in that band. Plus J.C. Higginbotham, Charlie Holmes, a band that never got the credit. And those Fleischman's East broadcasts really illustrate, you know, how incredible they were. So that was 13 weeks. The following year, Hollywood called again, and Armstrong appeared in a film called Going Places. Dick Powell was the star. Ronald Reagan was in the film. Yeah, it's a comedy. It's about a horse racing. I won't get into the plot. But Louis had a meaty role in this one. And once again, he named this as one of his proudest accomplishments. And this is usually the film that people hold up as like the best example of Hollywood just totally abusing the talents. And it's true, because in this film, Louis Armstrong sings the song Jeepers Creepers, which became nominated for an Academy Award as Song of the Year, and he sings it to a horse. And so it's just like, how humiliating can it get? And people have written about this. But in the Armstrong archives, we have letters. Louis wrote letters to friends, and there's one letter from right before filming started in which he said, love to do comedy for these motion picture stars. And it goes in a whole paragraph about how he loves doing comedic roles. He loves this kind of stuff. And then when the movie ended, he said he hated to get off the set. He had so much fun. And so, you know, we can write a larger dissertation about, like I said, problems with African-American representation in Hollywood. But Lewis himself, you know, he had that side to him. And I think he knew that, you know, he was funny. And Joe Glazer, his manager, took the Going Places campaign and made a whole ad campaign, you know, because the New York Times called him a solid man for comedy. And they did a full page in Billboard, a full page in Variety, just about Armstrong's comedic instinct. So my book also tries to reclaim Armstrong the comedian, because I do think he's a natural comedian. I think it's almost as hard to land a punchline as it is to land a high C. And the fact that Armstrong was gifted at that is not something that we should, you know, be embarrassed about, because he knew he was funny. And so here is the controversial Jeepers Creepers scene, but he's, you know, again, he makes the song come alive, and it's so goofy with the close-ups of the horse and all that, but he plays beautifully, he sings beautifully, and people are still playing the song to this day because of this performance.
There ain't no sure winners. That's why we're here. Come on.
Don't care what the weatherman says. When the weatherman says it's raining, you'll never hear me complaining. I'm certain sunshine. I don't care how the weatherman points. When the weatherman points to gloomy, it's got to be sunny to me. When your eyes look into mine. Oh, jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those peepers? Jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those eyes? Oh gosh, all get up, I'd to get so lit up. Gosh, all get up, I'd to get that size. Oh golly gee, when you turn the heaters on, woe is me, got to put my cheetahs on. Jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those peepers? All of those weepers have hypnotized.
Yeah.
Where'd you get those eyes,
Gate?
Where'd you get those eyes,
Thatch?
Where'd you get those eyes? Papa, do 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 do.
Yes, nobody else could pull that off but Louis Armstrong. So, you know, again, nominated for an Academy Award, the song, and Louis lists that in 1941 as one of his great accomplishments. And then when Cabin in the Sky finally comes out, you know, pioneering all-black film, Armstrong's role is comedic. He plays 11 seconds of trumpet and plays the hell out of it, but he's in a Rex Ingram and all these major African-American actors and comedians, and Lewis bragged about that too, that his line saved the scene and cut everybody, and he was more natural than all of them. So that's Armstrong the comedian. But by 43, 44, 45, all of a sudden these meaty roles, the comedic roles, the acting roles, they all dry up, and now Armstrong just comes on and does a song and leaves. And usually those are the only memorable moments from these films, and I'm going to show two of them for you back-to-back. Is where my book begins in 29. The two songs that really ensured Armstrong's crossover appeal were I Can't Give You Anything But Love and Ain't Misbehaving. And here he is in the 40s, still doing those songs beautifully. I Can't Give You Anything But Love comes from a film called Jam Session. It's Armstrong's only appearance. He comes and he does it. He plays a bartender. Look for a sign in the back that says Louis Armstrong Cocktail. There needs to be a Louis Armstrong Cocktail in this city. But again, he sings, plays beautifully. Still Louise Russell's band. And then I'll show you from a movie called Atlantic City, Louis doing Ain't Misbehaving, introduced by Dorothy Dandridge. There's some dialogue over it. He still plays in the background. And again, I mentioned Maxine Gordon will be here tomorrow. If you look in the Ain't Misbehaving clip, Dexter Gordon is back there from his 6 months in the Armstrong band. So let's open up with Jam Session. I Can't Give You Anything But Love.
Okay, Martin, let's have Louis Armstrong.
Louis Armstrong.
can't give you anything but love. Baby, that's the only thing I've plenty of. Baby.
Did I step on it again? I'm sorry.
You should find, oh, happiness. And I guess all those things you're crying for, baby. Gee, I'd like to see you looking swell. Baby, diamond bracelets were worth doesn't sell. Oh, baby, doo-doo, tell that lucky day. You know darn well, baby, I can't give you anything but love. Lucky day, you know darn well, baby, I can't give you anything, anything but love. That's the only thing I've plenty of. I can't give you anything but love.
Go ahead. I like enthusiasm.
I like enthusiasm, too, so feel free to applaud if you... And now here is from Atlantic City, Ain't Misbehaving, next to Dorothy Dandridge.
Ladies and gentlemen, happy days are here again. It's Harlem on parade. Though tickets may be high, still there's not a better buy than Harlem on parade. Turn on that heat, boys, and throw it to me. Give me that beat, boys, to Charleston. Charleston, we are so refined. We never had a thing like this in mine in Harlem on parade. Now from the land where blues were born comes a man and a horn. That's him I'm shouting about. He's swinging up that man with the horn. The man with the horn.
No one to talk with, all by myself. No one to walk with, I'm happy on the shelf. Ain't misbehaving, save my love. Oh, baby, do that. No forsaking, the one I love. Through it plaining, you that I'm thinking of. Ain't misbehaving. saving my love. Like Jack Horner in a corner, don't go nowhere, and I don't care. All your kisses, me. I don't stay out late, leave Jen alone. I'm home about 8, just me and my gramophone. Ain't misbehaving, saving my love.
Selling that number. Look at that packed house. They seem to be enjoying it, too. You know what? Oh, what's the matter?
I'm actually going to kill it here because they talk over the rest of his solo.
I can wait.
He plays in the background, Hollywood. But just to see the vocal in the first half and seeing Dexter back there is beautiful. But that's the big band in the 40s. Sounds great. By 1946, though, there's a change in the air. There's the whole New Orleans revival going on. And there had been rumors for years. First, Orson Welles was going to make the story of how jazz was born down here. And then finally, in 1946, they announced they're going to tell the story of jazz, the story of Louis Armstrong, a movie called New Orleans. And we're going to bring back Louis Armstrong. We're going to hire Billie Holiday and Kid Ory, and everybody was all excited. And then they brought in like all these white leads and white writers, and they've had a whole white subplot. And they whited up the movie. And the good news about it is we get to see Louis, Kid Ory, Zooty Singleton, Barney Bigard, all these people play again. I like to play this just to show you what you're in for, though. The movie's going to tell the story of New Orleans jazz, and then it opens with Do You Know What It Means to Miss New Orleans, which was written for the film, but listen to this ultra-hip New Orleans version of that tune on the opening credits. That's enough of that. But you do get another special song. It's called Where the Blues Was Born in New Orleans. And on this one, Louis goes around and introduces the members of the band. And at the Armstrong House, we're opening this new center early next year, and Jason Moran is the curator. And Jason became obsessed with this clip because, you know, it's got the New Orleans beat and it looks like a big fun thing, but Louis is rapping. There's no way around it, especially if you take out his vocals. Somebody did this once on YouTube but then disappeared, and just put a hip-hop beat behind it. It's 100% pure, unadulterated hip-hop. So I'll show you this sequence, but when the band kicks in, once again, the white people swoop in and start talking over the music. But do not fret, I'll have a surprise after that.
Come gather round my stand and hear Satchmo's happy Dixie band. Now I know some people call it corn, but right here is where the blues were born. Hear that music, blue, just the thing that you like to strut to on the floor. Hear the slide trombone and the trumpet moan as you're coming through the door. I'll guarantee that you'll never see like the likes of them again. Stomp your feet to the beat of my Dixie music, men. Everybody move, get right in the groove. There ain't nothing you can
Billie
lose.
Billie Holiday.
Now right here's the spot where we'll all get hot with a nasty mess of blues. Here's the place to slap and spank that bass, hear the music. And I mean, this is where the blues is born, New Orleans. Let me introduce Mr. Charlie Beal. Piano man, can he spiel? Only got 2 hands, but that's a plenty. For when he plays, it sounds like 20. Here's Kid Ory on the horn. Greatest slide man ever born. Plays trombone smears with laughing notes. No human being ever wrote. Nobody knows Zooty Singleton can beat them sheepskins like no one. Cymbals, bells, and all that stuff. I'll give all the face and treat them rough. And then here's Bonnie B. God and his clarinet. You ain't never heard nothing like him yet. When he cuts loose, I know you'll roar. Mr. Big Eyes, please give me more. Now here's Bud Scott and his old guitar, always smoking that big cigar. He's the rhythm man of a great renown. Give a listen while he goes to town. Red Calendar, meet him face to face. He's the one that plays that old slap bass. He started out with a violin, and the doggone thing just grew up on him. And there's me, excuse my crust, introduce myself, my must. I'm Satchmo Armstrong, don't forget, I got to get up out on the old cornet. Mr. Nick, gambling man, and he's mighty slick. He's the boss man of this place and how. Mr. Nick, please stand up and take a bow.
Why, they almost make their instruments talk. Where does such music come from?
Well, it came from...
Now.
Miss Smith, you're going home.
Not intended.
In the background, it's the most incredible
song,
blues playing ever
West Africa.
Captured.
Little Christian churches, riverboats.
You want to make up words to it as you go along.
But we're stuck with this in the foreground.
Mr. Duquesne, why don't we hear more of this kind of music?
There's a wall around it, Miss Smith. A big invisible wall you can't climb over.
But why? Because it's new? All the wonderful music I've been singing. So traditional now.
All right.
It was new one.
That's enough of that. The funny part is when the movie ends, jazz has finally been accepted at Carnegie Hall. And who is the band performing at Carnegie Hall? Louis Armstrong played at Carnegie Hall. But who is the band that ends the film? Woody Herman, a white band. So there's this whole thing that's just kind of messed up. That's all I can say about it. But that blues that was going on in the background here is something incredible. It was an untitled slow blues recorded for the soundtrack. The soundtrack of New Orleans has been reissued many times. I actually saw it yesterday in the Louisiana Music Factory. Never with this blues. It's just, you know, there's no name for it. It's like it never existed. And then the great Stephen Lasker, who's a historian out of California, he's always watching auctions, and there's a lot of stuff in California because of the film industry. Well, they would make reference discs for the films, and on one of the reference discs was this blues. And what I'm about to play you has never been issued in any form. I just have to make sure I have it. I do have it somewhere around here. I'm searching for New Orleans, which is it's going to get me 1,000 results. But give me a second here. If not, I have it in my iTunes. But I thought it was a good way to close, even if it's not quite footage, because you saw them playing it and didn't hear, I mean, you couldn't hear the music. But let's go through iTunes, I guess, because this has left me. All right. And the name of it in my iTunes is Slow Blues with an exclamation point, because that's the first time I heard it. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. So, yeah, we don't need a visual on this. We'll just take you back to New Orleans. And it's all ensemble. Louis Armstrong, Kid Ory, Barney Bigard on clarinet, Charlie Beal on piano, Bud Scott on guitar, Red Calendar on bass, and Zooty Singleton on drums playing the blues for 4 minutes and 44 seconds. It's unreal. Enjoy. Thank you. Lewis using the mute very well. And that last chorus, that descending thing that he plays with those three notes, that's King Oliver. That's Oliver originally played that on Jazz and Baby Blues, and Lewis quoted it on Muggles. He quoted it again in the Ellington album. And so I think he's tapping into something there. Everything John McCusker talked about, just to hear Lewis and Ori and all that. No solos, just blowing like that. It's incredible. And, of course, the film New Orleans comes out in April of 47. Lewis begins doing all this small group performance to promote the film. He does an evening at Town Hall, and all of a sudden the big band is scrapped, the All-Stars are formed, and that's the story of my first book, What a Wonderful World. But today that was all 30s and 40s. Lewis in Hollywood, like I said, problematic. There's not the best representation, but he's always worth watching. The musicality is undeniable. And I hope you enjoyed these little clips here. And I should mention about the book real quick. I ordered 24 copies of the book. FedEx was supposed to arrive yesterday, and they are potentially delayed. They've never arrived. They're somewhere on a truck in Louisiana right now. So I have nothing. But I signed 50 copies at Octavia Books, and the Louisiana Music Factory has six. So if you have a desire to own a signed copy, they're in the city. But maybe they'll arrive from FedEx tonight, and I'll have some on me tomorrow. That's all I got. Thank you, and I'll see you in the morning.
Ricky, thank you as ever. And I'm very curious about your John McCormack.